So as a moderator, I'm obliged to speak in English. So I'd like to welcome you all and thank you all for coming to this panel named Direct Democracy, Theory, Experience and Perspectives. I'm Jelena, I'll be moderating today's session. I'll briefly introduce our speakers. So today we have Zdravko Popović from Academic Solidarity Croatia, Josip Jagić, Plenum or General Assembly of the Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences, also from Croatia. Luka, Mesec, we are the university movement from Slovenia. Jelena Veljić, student activist from Serbia who participated in a number of direct democratic struggles, mainly in the field of higher education. And Gordan Isabegović, member of movement youth movement Revolt from Bosnia and Herzegovina. The conclusions will be made by Noah Treister from the organization Ignorant Schoolmaster and his committees. So I'll try to just briefly introduce the main issues of this panel. So all the participants are delegates or were and are active members of organizations that have for the last couple of years used and implemented direct democracy not only as a method but also as a political goal. It is important to notice before we start, I think, that direct democracy was not used as a method on a neutral political ground, but that all the organizations and participants were engaged in political struggles against neoliberal policies and mainly with anti-capitalist agenda. So today they will share some of their experiences. They will name some of the advantages of such organizing methods. They will also name some of the problems that the organizations encountered, and hopefully we'll all discuss future perspectives in the direct democratic struggles, and I hope we'll also discuss a higher degree of cooperation between all the organizations and participants of this panel. So now I will give the floor to, I think, Jelena Veljić is our first speaker.
Okay, during this conference, a comprehensive analysis were carried out as to the neoliberal changes that have been happening not only in the societies from which we come, but globally. More or less everyone agrees in terms of the diagnosis that the situation is getting worse and worse when it comes to the values of equality and community, the values of socialist thought and progressive organizing since their conception. Both these values have substantially been suppressed at the level of discourse as well as at the level of ongoing neoliberal policies to the extent that even their desirability have become challenged. We noted that socialization of production that was characteristic of the Soviet Union and Eastern Bloc countries, which was supposed to serve as a vehicle for social equality and community, had left the scene almost entirely over the last quarter century or so. Meanwhile, in the capitalist democracies and transitional countries, privatization has been pretty much on the agenda. Unfortunately, worker self-management has never been given a fair test. Those principles have been put in practice in Yugoslavia, but never to the point where enterprises were given full freedom in their production. On the other hand, socialization of consumption through welfare state, mostly the approach of social democrats in Europe and elsewhere, even in the places where it functioned, did not bring the desired results when it comes to the values in question. It didn't either reduce inequalities or strengthened community ties to the level socialists of any kind would be willing to approve. Anyhow, those are big topics and I won't be treating them here extensively. It appears obviously that at the Balkans, all of the means that supposed to bring about equality and community have been systematically undone in the transition. But by pursuing those goals of equality and community, in my practice or in our practices as activists, I would like to try to pinpoint how some forms of collective decision making can actually promote them. I believe those are places where sense of those values still could be found. I will not go into the definition of the technical aspects of establishing the direct democracy bodies, but some of the issues arisen from one specific practice which occurred during the occupation of School of Philosophy in Belgrade during the fall of 2011. And during the discussion, I won't be going into some more descriptive details, but I want to focus on some more conceptual issues that have arisen from this practice. So briefly, just a couple of thoughts on the subject. So establishment of direct democratic bodies, at least at the local level, should give all of the people to which certain decisions apply an opportunity to take part in decision-making process. In that way, providing, at least at the normative level, the equality in terms of distribution of the political power, that is, the power to make decisions. The other question is the question of community. Briefly, direct democracy is important for its potential to involve in the decision-making process different layers of society. It is a trivial point, but if we view Serbian society or any other of this kind as divided into interest groups, such as students or workers or LGBT people, different minorities, etc., which are mainly fighting for their own cause, direct democracy as a method has the potential to enable us to hear and discuss problems of the others. Sorry, I was just informed that I should speak maybe slowly. But I just wanted to save some time, sorry. So direct democracy practices can enable us to hear and discuss problems of the others, and as these problems are still our common problems, to overcome these divisions, that is identity politics. And ultimately, it can help establish the community. In the case of occupation of School of Philosophy, this experience of being together in large numbers proved to be very important in many respects. On the level of deliberation, the Belgrade experience shows that people have had the patience to listen to each other, to think, and to argue for their position, no matter how big the differences in approach have been. However, we should bear in mind that securing political equality, as defined earlier, as a distribution of power to make decisions through direct democracy will not necessarily resolve other substantial inequalities, at least not in the first steps. Primarily, I speak of gender equality, equality of different minority groups, LGBT people, Roma people, etc. However, the inclusive character of direct democracy bodies will lead to the greater representation and presence of groups and issues that are not always on mind of people who belong to the dominant majority of population. Another important issue lies in economical inequalities. Barbara Steiner was talking on this topic of participative and deliberative and direct democracy on some earlier panels. She was talking about student experiences in Austria in establishing Plenum as a direct democratic student body. And she mentioned that decisions are too often made by those who have the most time, that is, the one with greater economical power, which allows them to invest their time in the decision-making process. Also, people of different classes were not in an equal position to make argument for their case. Even though in most of the cases there was a goodwill of plenum participants to focus on an idea rather than focusing on its presentation, the class consciousness, so to say, must always be present in order not to discriminate someone as a participant of the deliberation. On some occasions, the lack of patience was shown, mostly in situations when different sides exhausted all of the arguments and kind of got stuck in a position where all of them were good and no additional argument could be used in order for the plenum to make a decision. Barbara also mentioned that in order to provide inclusion of minorities in some sense, sometimes it is necessary to exclude some of the participants, for example, homophobes or racists, that are not tolerant to different groups. Even if we established, as the practice in Belgrade shown at some point, some levels, if we establish a normative concept, it is not always possible to implement it in practice if individuals do not wish to follow or implement the decisions of the plenum. A less extreme example would be unilateral moves that some participants of the plenum make. Such is the case if decision is being made on an activity which would be done in the name of plenum. When plenum decides not to do it, and individuals do it anyway, and do it in a way that would not explicitly differentiate them from the plenum, that creates a tension which cannot easily be resolved. There is also one obstacle that was noticed. It is observed that the people who have any kind of, say, frustrating experience can easily identify the notion of plenum with an instance of it. In a way, they tend to conflate the idea with its realization. So these are only some of the issues that occurred from this particular practice. I'm sorry, because maybe some of these issues were more abstract. We can talk about some description of events maybe later during the discussions. But the point is in this. Having all this in mind, especially considering the fact that direct involvement of all to which decisions relate in the decision-making process, direct democracy should remain one of the primary ways of progressive organizing today. Its implementation still requires a lot of practice, and hopefully, with regard to how things are developing now, we will have more and more material to work on in order to articulate and better its ways. However, in parallel with development of these models of decision making, we need to work on all those issues that will remain open even after the implementation of direct democratic procedures. And these are the issues of equality and presence in terms of gender, sexuality, nationality, race, and class. So this was my intention, just to pinpoint few examples and few issues, and so maybe we can, during the discussion, open even more problems.
Okay, thank you for pointing to some issues that I hope we'll discuss later. And now our next speaker is Luka Mesec from We Are the University Slovenia, or Mi smo Univerza iz Slovenije. So Luka, could you tell us a little bit more about the situation in Slovenia, about direct democratic practices over there?
Okay, thank you. I think that we should discuss the political situation in Slovenia and the issues about Mi smo Univerza maybe later in the debate, because I prepared rather an intervention about political importance of direct democracy and direct democracy as a political strategy. My belief that direct democracy has to be understood in the context of response of the so-called new left to the failures of the old left. By the old left, I mean this revolutionary Marxist-Leninist left on the one side, and reformist, socialist, and social democratic left on the other. After the reveals of the horrors of Stalinism, and especially after the collapse of the Eastern Bloc, the left is trying to avoid the Marxist-Leninist strategy as far as it can, because the Marxist-Leninist strategy is blamed to create structural possibilities to the rise of Stalinist despotism, and on the other hand, it tries to avoid party representation as social, classical socialists and social democrats, especially in the Western European, did, because it is understood that they accepted the rules of the bourgeois politics and were therefore unable to transform the capitalist society into socialist or communist one. Therefore, direct democracy seems as a logical response because it does not tend to take power and transform the society top down, but it rather is a political strategy that is trying to conduct a revolution from bottom up. So. In that sense, it seems a logical response, but I think that the movements based on direct democracy, direct democratic principles, especially in the last years, had shown that direct democracy is far from ideal strategy for the political left. Maybe at this point I will include some points of our experiences with the direct democracy in Ljubljana, especially with the movement Mi smo Univerza, We Are the University in English, that occupied the Faculty of Arts in Ljubljana for 3 months. We tried in a way to conduct a rebellion that was found on very rigid direct democratical principles like non-hierarchy, non-representation, abolishment, practical abolishment of the division of labor. And I will shortly describe those points because I think that are not only organizational flaws that could be, I don't know, I wouldn't say that the failure of Mismo Universa, I will call it a failure because I think it was at the first day of the occupation, there were 300 people, and after 3 months there were like 8 people who survived this 3 month occupation. So firstly, I think that I will start with non-hierarchical principles and the possibility of let's start with division of labor. our movement, Mismo Universa, was based on the rotation of functions. So, for instance, if we had a moderator one day who was able to perform his functions perfectly, he should be replaced the other day with another moderator who didn't know how to conduct democratic debate because he didn't have experience and didn't have the knowledge. And I think here we stick to the these direct democratic principles that everyone should get a chance and everyone should be equal, but this kind of logic neglects the different experience that people have. And that is why the debates were always dependent on the inexperienced moderators, and the knowledge didn't transfer, because here we should transform this logic that a moderator who is capable of conducting a quality debate should teach or train the others to do it as well as he could, and then they should be able to conduct these debates. So at this point, I think that we should implement some kind of hierarchy, so the people who have knowledge train and teach the others to perform those tasks as good as they can. And at this point, I think professionalization of the activists should be more in place than plain equality that is ineffective and counterproductive. The other point is non-representation, which also was flawed by this by principles that revolution should not have faces, and that is why we should always send other people to talk to media, and they should not be always the same. So we would really turn out as a democratic community of equals. But what turned out was that our media representation was uncoordinated. It was very confusing because there were always different people who had different aspects, and they didn't really represent the initiative. They just presented their own opinions because they could be people that even didn't attend all the plenums, and so they would know what is the initiative really about. And at this point, I think that we should stick to some kind of representation. Because once again, it would be better to have some kind of division of labor and some kind of hierarchical transfer of knowledge, so the people could learn to perform those tasks and to represent the initiative. And last but not least, I think that Mismo Universa and also other similar direct democratic initiative turned out as politically impotent. In our particular case, the main flaw was that because of the confusing or non-hierarchical organizations and long and unproductive debates, most of the people quit the initiative after a week or two, and then only a few people stayed that still resisted. And that is how our initiative collapsed after 3 months. But also we have examples when the direct democratic principles were able to raise hundreds of or tens of thousands of people to the streets. We have that example in Egypt or in Spain. And but they are also political impotent. I think that good example is Egypt, because there this Tahrir Square and the movement around it was able to cut off President Mubarak, but after the fall of President Mubarak, there was no program, there was no coordination, and there was no political representation of the movement that could conduct the post-revolutionary Egypt, if we could say so. And that is why now the army took the power, and after that it is possible that the Islamists will take the power, because they are organized force in contrast of this direct democratic mass movement of Tahrir Square, which is unorganized, it doesn't have political program, and it doesn't have representatives. In Spain, the situation is even worse, because we have this strong 15-0 movement that also raises thousands and thousands of people and to the streets, and a lot of energy is consumed in it, but their influence is minimal. They still have a neoliberal government, and they can do nothing about it, and it doesn't seem that their movement will really make a change. So I think that the only way out of this mess is a Greek example. And when I say Greek example, I mean Syriza. Syriza is a party that joined all those movements into People's Front, and now they are competing in the elections, and it looks like that they will win the next Greek elections in June. And they are some kind of coexistence of the old and the new left principles. They are democratic inside the party, because they are a People's Front, a coalition of democratic movements, and they are also play along the line of the old left. They have a party formed, and they have trade unions included, and so they will fight in the field of the bourgeois democracy. And I think that is the way, and that is the only perspective of direct democracy. So to conclude in a sentence, I think that direct democracy as a political method is time consuming and unproductive, and time consuming and unproductive, but direct democracy as a political goal must remain. That is all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Okay, you certainly opened up a lot of issues here. So now Zdravko will speak something about academic solidarity, the first direct democratic union in Croatia, and also he'll talk about the issue of political strategies, as well as some organizational problems that Luka mentioned.
Hello, everyone. I will speak in Croatian just to even things up a bit, and I'll be much quicker this way. So I'll also be shorter than. Akademska solidarnost je, a možemo reći, nastala kao dugo željeno dijete plenuma Filozofskog fakulteta u Zagrebu. Dakle, nešto što će Josip predstavljati kasnije. Ona je nastala kao inicijativa u vrijeme kad je prošla vlada Republike Hrvatske, pokušala implementirati tri nova zakona vezana uz znanost i visoko obrazovanje, dakle zakon o znanosti, zakon o visoko obrazovanju i zakon o sveučilištu, koji su naravno, kao što se to sada u svijetu događa, bili koncipirani na toj neoliberalnoj agendi koja bi drastično komercijalizirala sve te aspekte iz znanosti i visokog obrazovanja. I tada je krenuo otpor, dakle više od tog trenutka nadalje nisu bili samo studenti ti koji su se aktivno oko nečega borili. To je malo probudilo i profesore, prvenstveno profesore sa Filozofskog fakulteta u Zagrebu, ali nisu oni bili jedini, priključili su se i neki drugi, ima ih i sa drugih fakulteta, kako je cijela inicijativa rasla, tako je i broj ljudi rastao. Akademska solidarnost je prvo nastala kao inicijativa koja je pokušavala u javnost progurati objašnjenja zašto su ovi zakoni štetni, jer nastale prvenstveno zbog sprječavanja donošenja novih zakona. Sindikat koji je zadužen za znanost i visoko obrazovanje u Hrvatskoj, dakle nezavisni sindikat znanosti i visokog obrazovanja, je zagovarao te zakone. Dakle, oni su bili u uskoj suradnji, vrlo uskoj suradnji sa Ministarstvom znanosti i visokog obrazovanja, dakle sa državom. Oni su zapravo su najveći dio kampanje zagovaranja tih zakona i objašnjavanja drugima da se protiv toga ne treba boriti, upravo vodio taj sindikat. Kao odgovor na to je onda akademska solidarnost, da bi uopće ljudi koji su spremni u borbi protiv tih zakona ući u štrajk i da to bude legalno, tako je akademska solidarnost na proljeće prošle godine iz inicijative prerasla u sindikat, jel tako smo se registrirali da bi mogli štrajkati. To je zapravo bio jedini porez zbog čega se sindikat i osnivao. NSZVO, Nezavisni sindikat znanosti i visokog obrazovanja, je tada pokrenuo još veću hajku na tu grupu ljudi. To oni čak su išli tvrditi da je takav zakon, da je takav štrajk nezakonit, jer da se radnici mogu boriti jedino za stvari koje se tiču njihove plaće. To je nešto što se počelo onda gurati u javnost. Što naravno nije točno, jer zakon definira razno razne razloge zašto se može ići u štrajk. To je nešto što bi isto svaki radnik trebao proučiti. Akcija akademske solidarnosti je dovela do toga da je zapravo uspjela probuditi i ostatak akademske zajednice, koji je bio i prije, a i sad je poprilično neaktivan što se tiče uopće društva i politike. Koji su čak i na nekakvim i ideološki drugim pozicijama, ali ovi zakoni su toliko agresivno bili neoliberalni da su zapravo uplašili čak i njih. Jel? I zapravo akademska solidarnost sa svojim djelovanjem, koliko je akademska solidarnost bila radikalnija, toliko su ovi ostali uspjeli pratiti to za korak iza. Jel? Akademska solidarnost je na kraju jedina koja je ušla u štrajk, ali je sveučilište u Zagrebu bilo spremno na jesen obustaviti nastavu, na primjer. Znači, mi smo cijelo vrijeme, kako je akademska solidarnost vodila u tom zaoštravanju stvari, tako je ostatak zajednice to koliko god uspavan i neaktivan bio nekako slijedio. Rezultat toga je bio da su ti zakoni srušeni. Dakle, uspjelo se spriječiti da se ti zakoni donesu. Sljedeća velika stvar koju je akademska solidarnost napravila je deklaracija o znanosti i visokom obrazovanju, dakle deklaracija za strategiju o slaganju, jer Hrvatska već godinama tu strategiju nema. To je trenutno jedini takav dokument u Hrvatskoj. Usprkos tome što vlast nije napravila još uvijek takav dokument i sada i ova nova vlada pokušava krenuti u izmjene zakona o znanosti i visokom obrazovanju koji su ne na sličnom nego na identičnom tragu i onih prošlih zakona, to se čak i u jezičnoj, u samim rečenicama može vidjeti koliko su oni isti. Znači, pred akademskom solidarnosti sad je borba s ovom novom vlasti koja možemo očekivati da će biti još teža jer je ova nova vlast nominalno lijeva. I to je onaj najveći problem. Zapravo uvijek ti je lakše s onima koje možeš, jel, onu etiketu koju si im stavio na čelo, ona i stoji. Dakle, to je ukratko što akademska solidarnost je. Ona je ono što je, zbog čega se predstavlja u ovom okruglom stolu, je to što je to između ostalog i prvi sindikat u Hrvatskoj koji je direktno demokratski ustrojen. Dakle, naši zakoni omogućavaju i to da udruge budu direktno demokratski ustrojene. Još jedna stvar, znači taj, sama riječ akademska solidarnost, ideju solidarnosti razvija i na taj način ko sve mogu biti njeni članovi. Dakle, članovi akademske solidarnosti nisu samo profesori na fakultetima, diplomirani znanstvenici, to njihovi asistenti, nego to mogu biti svi zaposlenici u institucijama koje se bave znanošću i visokom obrazovanjem, kao i svi studenti, pa onda čak i svi građani. Jel? Primjer koliko je to točno možemo vidjeti upravo u tome da sam ja taj koji predstavlja akademsku solidarnost, koji nisam profesor, ja sam student i to još spadam u onu grupu vječnih studenata. Jel? Ja sam zapravo teret društva, kako to država danas govori. Jel? Dakle, evo, mene su poslali. Znači, stvarno je tako kako zagovaraju. Što se tiče ove, dakle, kad smo ovako ograničeni vremenom, onda jedino u nabačajima i možemo govoriti. Jel? Što se tiče neke ove općenitije perspektive direktne demokracije, jel, u principu govorimo o tome kako doći do direktno demokratskog društva. Jel? Dakle, ovo sad dalje ne govorim kao predstavnik akademske solidarnosti, nego osobno, jer se o tim stvarima na samoj akademskoj solidarnosti nije raspravljalo službeno. Ja osobno zagovaram koncept kojeg je Mate Kapović u ovom tekstu, njegovom direktnoj demokraciji, sad u ovom zborniku Up and Underground, nazvao potpuno bezumnim. Naime, ja smatram da pokušaj sudjelovanja u vlasti i preuzimanje vlasti nije rješenje, zato što to onda upravo negira samo ideju direktne demokracije. Ideja direktne demokracije je sudjelovanje, je stvaranje onog svijeta oko sebe kako ti smatraš da bi ti trebao biti sad i odmah. Jel? To se izlaskom na izbore, pa onda eventualnim posljednim rješavanjem, ja osobno mislim, ne rješava. Jel? Ono što mi trebamo činiti i ulagati trud je zapravo sprovoditi direktnu akciju. Ako smatramo da treba direktno demokratski djelovati, onda to tako treba početi i činiti. Jel? To bi mogli uzeti kao razliku između legitimiteta i legaliteta. Masu stvari koje ćemo raditi, ako ćemo tako promatrati svijet, neće biti legalne, ali će biti legitimne zato što ćemo mi kao grupa zaključiti da tako treba. Dakle, nećemo vršiti građansku neposlušnost da bi onda nešto tako dobili unutar postojećih zakona, nego ćemo stvarati svoje zakone direktnim djelovanjem. To je ono što smo i jučer pričali u ovim pripremnim razgovorima za ovaj stol. Jel, rekli smo da ćemo reći ono zašto niste bili jučer, koliko god da niko za to nije znao. Dakle, onaj ključni element uopće u zadržavanju ljudi u direktno demokratskom djelovanju zapravo nije mobilizacija, nego subjektivizacija. Jel? Ljudi se moraju osjetiti subjektima onoga što rade. Oni moraju osjetiti da je to njihova aktivnost i da ona odmah tu trenutno ima utjecaja. Bilo koji dolazak odozgo, recimo nekakvog eventualnog preuzimanja vlasti, pa onda implementiranja direktne demokracije, je već samo po sebi objektivizacija i zapravo će uništiti vlastitu ideju. Što se tiče pak ovog surađivanja nas organizacija koje već postojimo, tako da, naravno, treba se povezati, treba komunicirati, ali način na koji trebamo komunicirati nije samo taj da mi govorimo o našim uspjesima jedni drugima, kao što sad radimo ovdje, naravno da treba i to, jel? To je i informacija i motivacija. Nije samo ni to da se sad mi, kad se dogodi nekakav određeni konkretni projekt, pa da sad mi zajedno nešto oko toga idemo djelovati, to postoji mogućnost suradnje u tim među trenucima gdje mi zapravo trebamo analizirati i bilježiti vlastitu direktno demokratsku praksu i razmjenjivati iskustva. Mislim da to je jedan aspekt koji se uopće ne događa, a mislim da bi čak bio i najvrjedniji. I to na takav način da ne govorimo samo o svojim uspjesima, nego da analiziramo i vlastite greške i da na primjeru grešaka, nešto što si ti spominjao, vidimo kako to poboljšati. Jel? Znači, čisto operativno kako krenuti dalje. Evo, toliko za sad od mene, pa ćemo dalje vidjeti u raspravi.
Okay, thank you. I think you've made the discussion a lot more interesting, especially with your input about political strategies. Our next speaker is Gordan from Revolt Youth Movement, a group of university and high school students in Tuzla. Engaged not only in issues about concerning higher education, but also other issues relevant in Bosnia and Herzegovina. So, could you tell us, please, something more about it?
Thank you, Jelena. I will also address you in Bosnian. I didn't know, I came lately, last day, so I didn't know what's official language. So I prepared this concept in Bosnian. So. If you have any questions, you can make it in English, of course. Ja ću vam se obratiti kao član jedan od osnivača omladinskog pokreta Revolt organizacije koja je osnovana u Tuzli prije nekih malo više od 6 godina. I čisto mala ispravka, Revolt nije neformalna grupa građana, Revolt je registrovana kao nevladna organizacija sa ciljem ujedinjavanja lijevo orijentisanih mladih ljudi koji su tada prije 6 godina i sada imali namjeru da se bore protiv nacionalizma, religijskog šovinizma, socijalnih nepravdi, svi oni problema koje pogađaju mlade ljude, ali i sve ostale i ostale građane u Bosni i Hercegovini. Mi smo, da kažem, jedna od organizacija koja je većinu stvari koje je naučila je usput. U samim početcima mi, mogu slovno da kažem, nismo imali neku razvijenu ideološku pozadinu, osim, znači, neki, ja da kažem, osnovnih lijevih postulata. I čak smo i, kada smo se registrovali, ajde da kažem, klasičnu nevladnu organizaciju koja je imala svoju skupštinu, upravni odbor, predsjednike i te neke ostale funkcije, ali zapravo smo tokom djelovanja prirodno, nametnulo se kao sasvim prirodno, da smo počeli djelovati totalno horizontalno i direktno demokratski, jer smo skontali smo da su te funkcije koje smo u samim početcima bili uspostavili poprilično besmislene, tako da su ti organi koji danas stoje formalno u statutu, danas zapravo, mislim, jednostavno nisu, se ne poštuju. Ono što je bitno je su zapravo ravnopravnost članova, bez obzira da li je neko tu od samog početka ili dolazi na prvi sastanak. Revolt je sebi postavio, da kažem, za neki cilj, sad to je imalo neki i prednosti i mana, ali bavimo se jako širokom lepezom raznih aktivnosti, znači od onih čisto političkih aktivnosti, nekih političkih kampanja, do organizacije nekih, da kažem, koncerata ili čak nekih sportskih turnira i tako dalje. Ali u jednu ruku, mislim, pokazalo se naravno kao negativno, jer crpi prilično mnogo energije, ali s druge strane se ta neka kombinacija političkog i nepolitičkog djelovanja pokazala kao jako korisno, jer smo i kroz, ajde kažem, manje nepolitične ili manje politične stvari uspjeli da pridobijemo mnogo novih članova. Jedna od aktivnosti koju mogu da spomenem, koja je to direktno povezana i za ovu temu, bio jedan protest 2009. godine koji smo radili baš po pitanju, pošto, ajde kažem, naravno studentska populacija i studentska prava su među nekim prioritetima djelovanja. I nekad početkom 2009. godine Univerzitet u Tuzli je izašao sa prijedlogom da tumačenjem jedne odredbe statuta Univerziteta u Tuzli podigne školarine za određenu grupu studenata, to se kod nas zove studenti, mislim, naziv je idiotski, ali kao studenti za vlastite potrebe, to su kao vi samo finansirajući, to su kao samo finansirajući studenti. I to je, univerzitet je to htio prilično na mala vrata da progura, obzirom da se radi jednoj prilično zamršenoj toj pravnoj odredbi, statutarnoj. I onda smo mi tu malo istraživali, nas par, da smo bili pravnici u nastajanju, smo analizirali tu odredbu i izašli smo, to je bilo maltene da prođe. Nakon što smo mi analizirali, stvarno smo vidjeli da je to bila totalna manipulacija tom odredbom i da nisu bili u pravu. Izašli smo sa saopštenjem gdje smo objasnili u čemu je greška i da zaista nemaju pravo na osnovu te odredbe povećati školarine. I na protestu koji se desio, tako činim se, na proljeće 2009. godine, to je, da kažem, prvi uspješan protest u Tuzli nakon, možda i prvi, možda ili nakon mnogo vremena, kojim su studenti zaista uspjeli, znači, prvom blokadom univerziteta, pa onda nakon što su iz univerziteta ih uputili na vladu, pa onda nazad, zauzeli su zgradu filozofskog fakulteta u okviru koje se nalazi senat, odnosno rektorat, prekinuli sjednicu senata i bukvalno primorali dekane svakog fakulteta i samog rektora da izađe pred studente i da kaže da tu odluku povlače. Tako da je to, mislim, osim toga što smo spriječili povećanje školarina, taj protest je značajan baš iz razloga što je bio prvi te prirode da se zaista ljudima pokazalo da se može nešto da uradi ako se istupi organizovano i ako se istupi argumentovano. Kad je pitanje samo direktno demokratsko organizovanje, naravno osim same pravičnosti i uključenosti svih članova, što je apsolutno potrebno, ja jednu od svrha vidim u tome što je jako dobar mehanizam da spriječi nastanak bilo kakvih ličnih oportunističkih ambicija, a to je nešto što je sigurno mnoge inicijative koje su bile dobre na početku uništilo kasnije kada se pojavio lider koji zapravo čitavu stvar iskoriste za svoj korist. Što se tiče samog liderstva, to je nešto što mi nismo mogli da izbjegnemo. Jer, mislim, kada se organizacija, da kažem, bavi jednom stvari, ukoliko ima jedan zahtjev, mislim da je puno lakše istupati depersonalizovano. Međutim, mi nismo uspjeli da izbjegnemo tu posljedicu, obzirom da se bavimo kao sa jako mnogo aktivnosti, da su nakon nekog vremena da se stvorilo nekoliko ljudi koji naravno formalno nisu bili lideri, ali u praksi zaista jesu. I to ne nekim nametanjem, nečim drugim, nego jednostavno zainteresovanošću i učešćem u organizaciji raznih aktivnosti sa inicijativama koje su predlagali. I to je problem sa kojima se suočavamo i sad, obzirom da imamo tu smjenu generacija, tako da se osjeti malo sad odlazak nekih ljudi koji su bili jako, jako aktivni u prošlosti. Kratko ću samo isto da se osvrnem na sam problem tog balansa između direktno demokratskog organizovanja, uključenosti u donošenje svih odluka i same efikasnosti, jer mislim da je to nešto što uvijek trebamo iznova da se ispitujemo, a i sam sam često bio mnogo puta u situacijama da smo pretjeranim, da kažem, iscrpljivanjem direktno demokratskih mehanizama i beskonačnim raspravama o nekim odlukama koji nisu, da kažem, bile suštinski i bitne, sigurno dolazili u situaciji da smo i gubili pojedine članove, jer neki ljudi dođu, da kažem, prevashodno radi akcije. Bila je, znam, takve situacija kada se zaista previše, evo, po mojom mišljenju, vremena utrošeno u diskusije, zbog čega je ispaštao sam aktivizam i ono zbog čega smo i mi sami osnovani, a to je da, znači, djelujemo, da utječemo na ljude i da mijenjamo društvo. Ja ću samo kratko, obzirom da se sa tog organizacijskog nivoa podižemo na te neke više društvene razine, spomenut ću, mislim, par stvari. Naravno, stav Revolta i stav mnogih lijevih organizacije, naravno, podizanjem direktno demokratskih mehanizama i na više razine, ali tu također moramo se suočiti sa problemom, a tu bih volio da čujem, mislim, mišljenje i ostali sagovornika same desnice, jer, mislim, pojedini mehanizmi mogu biti vrlo lako oružje sami desničarski grupa, pogotovo u sadašnjoj situaciji kada imamo mas medije koji su pod dominacijom krupnog kapitala, postojeći obrazovni sistem i religijske zajednice koji također vrše indoktrinaciju ljudi od malih nogu. Tako da, vrlo je moguće, ja sam siguran da je mnogo, hajde da kažem, naselja u Bosni i Hercegovini, širom Balkana, čiji bi građani da mogu na referendumu se izjasnili da recimo uklone romsko naselje koje je recimo odmah pored njihovog. Tako da, mislim, te stvari trebamo uvijek preispitivati, uvijek treba, u tom smislu također je nužno direktnu demokratiju povezati, mislim da je to bile priče o tome i na prošlom panelu sa ekonomskom demokratijom. Ja sam mišljenja da su direktna i ekonomska demokratija nužno povezane, jer zagovarati direktno demokratske mehanizme, referendume, opozive i tako dalje, naravno, to treba raditi, ali to je, valjda da kažem, reformizam. Dok se puna emancipacija društva, po mom mišljenju, može samo uspostaviti i postići i sa afirmacijom i same ekonomske demokratije. Tako da ja neću dalje da žurim, da dužim. To je sve za sad, da pitam koliko budete imali. Izvolite.
Okay, thank you, especially for introducing new argument of economic democracy that we've already heard in the previous session. So our last speaker today is Josip Jagić, representing the General Assembly of the Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences in Zagreb.
First of all, I'm going to speak to you in English, but if I find it difficult during my exposé, I'm going to switch to, Serbo-Croatian or whatever. So, whatever they call it nowadays. So, first of all, just a few remarks about the organization where I come from. When I say plenum, I generally mean General Assembly, which is organizational body on the principles of direct democracy. It's functioning for 3 years now. The moment it was constituted, it was during the occupation of the faculty building in the April of 2009, like 3 years ago, and it was the central political and decision body in which everybody that was everybody that thought or felt that it was his right to come there and discuss the issues at hand, he had that right. He could discuss the issues at hand and consequently to that vote for it. As I said, we are functioning 3 years in continuity. We are functioning, yeah, but the nature of that functioning relatively or absolutely changed during these years. That's just a general or broad introduction about Plenum or General Assembly of the Faculty of Humane and Social Sciences in Zagreb. At the beginning, it would be I think it would be good to point out that I'm a bit in a catchy position because all of this that I'm gonna present you wasn't talked and discussed on plenum or in, or General Assembly, and these probably are mine views of that thing. So bear in mind that, and also bear in mind that I promised my comrade here to be brief and short within the 7 minutes. So I tend to fulfill that promise, and because I have to be, I will fail. Huh? Because I have, because I have to be economical for time. There will probably be a lot of reductions or something like that. So, that's just in order to prepare you for it, right? So, there are two major issues that were concerned, that were pointed out already in this debate by the comrades down there and by comrade by my right. Well, these two major issues. One of them was the rotational functions. Of course, I'm gonna narrow it down to these two major issues which come from my view, from the experience of the practice of direct democracy in the General Assembly, and for these 3 years. And I think that it should be something that we should think about. I'll try to deepen the story about these two major issues. So, as I said earlier, it was the rotation of functions. We called it the policy of depersonalization. My view of it is that our core of the law of that logic that we implemented that kind of policy was trying to avoid the leader's cult, right? So we bore in mind that that specific media logic that was dominant in our current society. So we knew that basically how things gonna wrap up were in the way that they're gonna look for a pretty face and and he's gonna be a leader and all that. That was, we wanted to completely sideline that kind of thing, and well, we succeeded it. And of course there were some of the negative sides of it that my colleague spoke of, and that was that during these rotations lots of people didn't cope good with their functions as spokesmen or something like that. So but the other aspect of it except this media logic was also the subjectivization of wider range of people. That's something that Zdravko was telling us earlier. So we tried to, it functions on two aspects. The first aspect is like external. This is like this media policy that we rotated every day. The spokesman who brought the public statements on everyday basis and things like that, So we avoided this kind of representation, right? And and the another aspect of this policy was internal, and that was during the discussions at Plenum or General Assembly. We tried, to somehow decontaminate the territory of any hierarchy, right? Of any relationships of power, in order to bring a lot of new people who never were political activists, who never had any experience in a political arena. So we wanted to bring all of them, to make them subjects, political subjects, in which they would come to plenum and they would participate in discussions and so on. So that was this policy of this depersonalization that I think that. That we succeeded in it, and it resulted definitely in a subjectivization of a broad student body and even wider than student body, right? Because the citizens also could come on our plenum or general assembly and vote for it, because we thought that request or the political request, political request for the free education, was a part of wider social problem, So what I wanted to say is that we succeeded in it, but also there were lots of criticisms. in the way, in especially in this, of course, there was this criticism that you mentioned earlier, you know, that people weren't so good at giving, you know, public speeches or something like that, because they were always rotated and everything else. They had to lead, you know, every day we changed the people who were leading, who were moderating the plenum and everything else. And yeah, it was a bit clumsy, but and in a matter of fact, a bit inefficient, but you know, that were the criticisms. But the bigger criticism that went towards this policy was that it didn't really make the whole thing, you know, leaderless in internal aspect, you know, because the criticism went in a way, you know, that during the discussions at plenum and while we were making some policies and making some decisions, some people just, you know, were dominant in those discussions, and that's something that my colleague mentioned earlier. And they somehow, you know, were much more, how should I say, well, they people, you know, by my view of it is that by the share power of their arguments, you know, they were something that people were listening to, and they thought that, you know, they had the right arguments, and then they mostly took those decisions, and they went towards those positions, and those positions were, you know, made the policies which would follow, which the plenum would then vote for and make their own. Yeah, so we kind of so that was the problem. It was a problem that lots of people, you know, were dominant in those discussions, and probably lots of other people who came for the first time, who didn't have so much political experience and everything, just, you know, didn't feel that the debate was open enough or something like that. So I think I went through the 7 minutes already, but sorry, I have another major issue to attend to. Yeah, so the other major issue, and the and it is concerned with the direct democracies, organizations of that kind of principle, is the issue of continuation. Yeah, thank you. So the issue of continuation, the issue of continuation of political struggle in direct democratic organizational forms. So, as I mentioned to you earlier, so the plenum of Faculty of Social and Humane Studies in Zagreb is active for 3 years. For 3 years, in the first those in the days of the occupying, in the days when we occupied the building, the faculty building, it was like, I don't know, the usual estimation of the people who were present and at those plenums were like, you know, figures between 800 people to 1,000 people, right? And things went very well. During the occupation of the building, which lasted like for a month, things were, and enthusiasm was high. Things went very good. But after the break of the occupation, the number of participants just went lower. It was a tendency going, you know, south, and that was the thing that we always during these 3 years. Tried to, you know, solve or fix or try to talk about what was the problem, what's happening, and why is it that's happening, right? So my view in some sense is that, you know, when we when you occupy a certain space like the faculty building, right? And you make that occupation last for like month or something, you do create some certain micro society or something like that with its specific values, which are, you know, well,
the whole existence of that micro society under this dominant society in which it was created is some kind of criticism towards this dominant society, you know, and those values like
solidarity, like camaraderie, like everything else, which are good, they you know, they last, but they aren't in a position to last indefinitely, because after some time, in our case it was 1 month, you're just in a position that you have to get back in that dominant society, and you know, for the shared reasons of reproduction, you know, people who were down there and who were occupying the faculty building were, you know, had at some certain point, you know, go to work outside that faculty building, outside that little micro society which was created with its own specific values and everything else. So that was the problem. It was the problem for also the students who were the biggest group, which you know, went through the occupying movement of a faculty building. It was a problem because they at some level, you know, had to go for their exams and things like that. So the pressure of the dominant society was, in my view, the pressure of this real life that was happening outside the building was something that that created so much pressure that at the same time, you know, we had to end the occupancy of the building, and that way, you know, we that way the safe haven which allowed people, you know, for relatively allowed, right, because they had to work and they had to do some things. Okay, just a minute. So it's just, you know, crumbled, and the people just weren't in a position no more. They went after the occupation, they went towards their own responsibilities and everything else, and they were not so much in a chance to, you know, to go every day on a plenum or be a part of some discussions. So yeah, without some going through it all, I wanted to point out these two issues, and maybe we could discuss it in the discussion afterwards. So yeah, that's about that's what I wanted to say. Sorry for going over 7 minutes.
Okay, thank you for this concise introduction and for keeping your promise. I'll now open the discussion. I assume that we will not be able to go through all the issues raised here. If I were to make an artificial division of these issues, I'd say that there are certainly problems concerning organizational structure and mechanism, and we certainly already shared some experience about it, and I hope other participants will try to resolve some of the mentioned issues, and perhaps the other aspect raised here was that of political strategies and future perspectives of direct democratic struggles. So I'll now open the discussion. Okay, we already have somebody, Nikola. Okay.
Well, I just have a few points to make, comments about what the friend from Slovenia said. So, first of all, it seems to me that concerning the Slovenian movement, you mentioned a lot of problems that don't really seem to come out of the type of organization, but really seem to come out of the lack of organizational capabilities or mistake in the field. So I'm not just saying this, like, theoretizing about this, because there are a lot of people here, for instance, that can give a completely opposite example of the student movement in Croatia, which also had all this, how to say, used all these instruments in the student movement without all the problems you had. But somehow it seems to me that the main problem of your argument was that you tried to present a direct democratic organization as exclusively or opposed to the some kind of classical leftism organization. Well, frankly, for me, it's hard to imagine either in the past or in the future a successful revolutionary movement that would not include both. So, I mean, that would not include both organized left and mass movement democratically organized with the organized left intervening in it. So, also the issues of different countries you mentioned, especially Spain, for instance, is the issue of the failure, well, let's say failure of the Spanish movement. For me, it doesn't seem to come out of the issue of democratic organizing. It seems to come out of the lack of the organized left intervening in this type of mass movement that could give it like a revolutionary impulse for real change, you know? And this is also somehow a bit of an issue in Egypt. I mean, the lack of organized left. But it seems to me when we talk about Egypt, and this is something that for instance, the activists who are active in all these movements in Egypt now talk really a lot about and talk really openly about is the enormous presence of police intervening, like secret services intervening in the movement in Egypt, and also the issue of Islamism in Egypt. I mean, it's not enough just to say that Islamists are organized. I mean, ever since the beginning of the movement, there is like millions of euros spent by the Turkish government, by the ruling AKP government, sending agents to participate in the Egyptian movement. So then again, I mean, this again shows that the failure of this liberal idea of like fascism or reactionary movement, that, you know, if the masses become too militant, then they will go crazy and become reactionary. I mean, it's not true. I mean, still again in Egypt, we see for the fact that the fascism, the reactionary movement, does not come out of the masses going wild, but it comes out from the organized intervention by the state and by imperialism. And I mean, the last point, to try not to take too much time, the last point is Greece. I mean, there is so much euphoria about the election victory of Syriza on the left. The main problem of this seems, for me at least, to be that not enough people really remembered that this electoral success comes in a moment when the Greek bourgeoisie, the comprador bourgeoisie, organized or controlled by imperialism, is really giving up on parliamentarism and moving towards this other type of bourgeois government, that is fascism. You know, you had the situation with the Greek government practically forming the German government practically forming the Greek government, the coalition of all bourgeois parties together with the fascists. I mean, you now have the Golden Dawn fascist party, which the bourgeois in Greece really seems to be sliding towards fascism, you know, in different methods. So the left-wing euphoria about parliamentary success in a long-term perspective, I mean, it just won't do, you know, in the situation when just to win parliament in a situation where the ruling classes are giving up on parliamentarianism, it seems not just as a strategy that will not make success, but as a strategy that will lead to catastrophe, you know, for the left and for the Greek people. So.
Hi, I don't know if anybody wants to answer to this. I'm kind of shocked. I already have to ask my question. My question is, considering subjectivization of the student body, I think we can all agree that in all these countries that goal of subjectivization was accomplished at first. And then my opinion is that a second objectivization or a new objectivization appeared or came to place where a mass, where the majority was no longer considered competent to make decisions and participate in discussion due to, I don't know, different political orientations and thoughts, and they were quite oftenly described as ignorant because they were just different in opinion. And my questions are, can this be prevented, or at least can it be reversed in the opinion of today's speakers? Thank you.
What should I really odgovor?
Thanks. I actually have a sort of intra-audience question. I wanted to ask the speaker before, the questioner before, who was talking about Egypt. I don't know who that was. Do you say that there was, were you talking about fascism in Egypt? And what you would mean by that? I don't know if I misheard you.
It was just like try to respond to the worries of the Slovenian comrade who tried to say that that this rise of Islamism is somehow moving to the far right and moving to the reactionary movements. I'm not claiming that the current Islamism of Muslim Brotherhood or anything is fascism. You know, I'm not claiming that. Attempt to reply to this worry about mass movement in Egypt moving to the far right.
Okay. So we'll hear some answers from our participants.
Okay. I will answer to the two points of your reply. Firstly, about Egypt and Spain. My point there was that you cannot tackle an organized organized opponent with unorganized struggle. And that is why I think it's the main flaw in Egypt and in Spain. They are on the streets, they are loud, but they don't have an clear organization, a clear program, and a clear path how to make their changes. They are just, I don't know, a mess with a plurality of ideas and plans to change their own environment, but they are not unified in a way. And about direct democracy, I tried it. Yes, as you said, present its theoretical flaws, not organizational, because I don't know. For instance, in Ljubljana, we had three different approaches to the direct democracy. One was made by 15-0. It was made on direct action. It was efficient, but it was efficient to conduct, I don't know, a village before our stock market with 25 people living in it for half a year. And it cannot, I don't know, it cannot run a state economy or something. You cannot run it this way and organized only by direct democracy. You have to formalize the relations in society. And so, and maybe I will give you another example of Social Center Rog. Activists there are trying to invent some kind of direct democratic organizations for like 10 years, but it turned out because they are they are denying all formalization, all hierarchy, and so that there is actually no formal hierarchy or no formal differences between the activists and the between the activists of social center, but it turned out that their relations are hierarchical in an informal way. They have an informal leader who says he's not a leader, but it is clear he is, because for instance all the people around him are they either were there for 2 years and then leave, and the new members come. He's the only constant. That is one issue, and the other issue is that his word is almost always the first and the last word. So he opens the debate and he concludes the debate. So it's they call themselves that they are. They are not hierarchical, but it is obviously that they are. And I think that in this case, it would be better if their relations were formalized. So everyone would know, okay, you are you have this position, this role in our society. Your functions and this are this and that and those. Your mandate is this how of time bound, and you have this responsibility to hold. And you have to transfer your knowledge to the other members, so they will be able to perform your work after your mandate is passed. I think it would be better this way, because this pre-capitalist relations of individual dominance are the worst. And I think I believe they are just the opposite of what we want to achieve. That is all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Ja bih odgovorio na ovo pitanje o subjektivizaciji, a odgovorom na njega ću se zapravo nadovezati na ovu raspravu koja je tu počela. Kao prvo, subjektivizacija nije nešto što se može smatrati procesom koji će završiti. Jel? Nema sad te situacije, super, sad smo se mi subjektivizirali, sad možemo na miru dalje. Jel? To je nešto što konstantno traje. U principu, svi direktno demokratski procesi se trebaju shvaćati na takav način, to je ono što se u zapatističkoj teoretskoj misli zove politika hoda. Jel? Ti cijelo vrijeme, ti konstantno svoj sustav, ako je direktno demokratski, sa svakim sastankom, sa svakim djelovanjem stvaraš iz početka. I to je nešto što treba itekako imati na umu. Jer jednog trenutka kad smatraš da si stvar riješio, da je to je trenutak kad se stvar počinje raspadati. Jel? U skladu s tim, onda i ova rasprava koja je tu krenula, dakle, mi direktna demokracija je nešto što se mora vježbati. Nije dovoljno sebe deklarirati pobornikom direktne demokracije i onda sve što ja radim sad zato što ja to radim da je direktna demokracija. Jako puno grešaka nastaje upravo iz tog procesa. Dakle, kad idemo proučavati sebe, recimo, evo, možemo primjer ovo pitanje depersonalizacije. Evo. Sam koncept depersonalizacije se onda krene povezivati i sa pitanjem rotacije. I, mislim, depersonalizacija i rotacija, to nisu ista stvar. Mi kad govorimo o depersonalizaciji, govorimo o postavljanju zajednice prema van. Znači, kako se mi kao zajednica cijelom svijetu okolo dalje prezentiramo. I tu govorimo onda o depersonalizaciji. Što je, recimo, se dogodilo sa plenumom, pa su to u Filozofskom fakultetu u Zagrebu, što su onda preuzeli i drugi plenumi u drugim fakultetima koji su isto tako, gdje su studenti preuzeli kontrolu. Dakle, prema van se nije išlo sa imenima. Zato da se ne bi preko imena diskreditirala cijela ta priča, zato da se ne bi preko imena skretalo sa onog glavnog zbog čega se uopće krenulo u tu akciju, a to je bila borba za besplatno obrazovanje, zato da se konstantno taj jedan zahtjev može ponavljati, da se o njemu može govoriti, i pokazalo se koliko je to bilo teško i pokazalo se upravo koliko je ta odluka za depersonalizacijom bila dobra, jer se na osnovu toga ta ideja ipak u javnost uspjela progurati. Danas čak i oni koji su protiv te ideje barem znaju šta je to. Jel? Do tad se o tome uopće nije ni govorilo. kad ljudi povežu ovakve neke stvari, a čak i ako ih i zagovaraju, onda na kraju krenu u jednom smjeru koji rastura svaki sustav, pa tako i njihov vlastiti. Evo, to je pitanje, recimo, horizontalnost kao pitanje toga da onda zato što smo horizontalni da ne smijemo imati strukturu. To nije točno. Svaki sustav ima svoju strukturu, htjeli mi to ili ne, inače ne bi bio sustav. Jel? Samo je pitanje da li tu strukturu mi slažemo sami kontrolirano, pa onda znamo o čemu se radi, ili se taj sustav složio sam. Kad ti se sustav sam slaže, onda ti se događaju svi ti problemi koji uopće ne moraju postojati. To nije pitanje direktne demokracije kao takve. Plus što, mnoge inicijative propadnu. Kao da mnoge inicijative koje nisu direktno demokratski ustrojene, ne propadnu. Jel? Kao da taj dio odjednom prestajemo računati, sad mi vidimo jako puno inicijativa je stalo, pa šta ćemo mi sad u direktnoj demokraciji, može li ona opstati? Pogledajmo popis tih ovih drugih, pa ćemo vidjeti da je to tu negdje. Jel? I onda isto tako možemo vidjeti i direktno demokratske inicijative koje opstaju. Jel? To je onaj dio gdje bi mi trebali razmjenjivati iskustva, i to iskustva na osnovu vlastitih grešaka. Mi bi upravo o vlastitim greškama trebali pričati puno više da bi mogli biti što je kvalitetnije, jel, zajedno dalje.
Ciao, imam three, izvini, na engleskom. I have three points that I wanted to talk about very, very quickly. So firstly, the comrade from Slovenia, Luka, yeah? It just struck me that, again, you keep sort of bringing this up to say, well, look, we've got these sort of direct democratic demands, we've got these forms that we want to keep organizing, but the problem is we can't implement any kind of organizational intervention. We can't actually form this into a movement with clear demands that can actually start taking things forward. And so really what this is a question of is, how can we implement some kind of centralization of a movement that would still be democratic? And in that context, I think it's strange that you opened your discussion by saying we need to break completely from everything that came before, because you're talking about democratic centralism. You're talking about how we can actually try to reconcile a dialectic between democracy and centralization, and this has been theorized. And it's been theorized in a certain leftist tradition that I think becomes a little bit ideological if we just say, well, we're completely opposed to everything that came before, because I mean, things are much more complicated than that. And so I think we should sort of be a bit careful about how we start thinking about us, our movements as being completely a break with the past and moving forward, because we're actually bringing up the same problems that were brought up at the beginning of this century. People have written smart things about them. And that's not to say that we can just apply these ideas, you know, without any sort of consideration for how they differ in the contemporary situation, but it does mean that very smart people have already considered these questions, and we should be very careful about how we reject that tradition and how we relate to that tradition. The second point would be, direct democracy thrives in movements, and I think this is the problem. In that context, we have to be careful about fetishizing direct democracy, right? There's a danger in which you can have these movements over here, and we want these movements to be run democratically. We want absolute participation of everyone on an equal platform, because that's how we're going to be strongest, where everyone feels empowered, where everyone feels confident to actually take decisions and carry those decisions into a wider sphere. But that takes place in the context of a political movement with demands, with perspective. And so I think the danger, certainly one of the dangers of the Indignados movement in Spain, I don't think this is true of Egypt. I think in some ways, to compare Spain to Egypt when you have immense, immense state repression going on in Tahrir Square, I think is a bit unfair, and we should be very, very careful about doing that. But certainly with the Occupy movement and with the Indignados, there is a danger where a lot of these movements, initially starting with demands regarding, particularly Occupy Wall Street, the demands began with more democratic control of the economy, control of the banks out of the hands of investment bankers, and et cetera, quickly devolved into discussions about procedure, into discussions about whether or not hand gestures should mean this or that. And so, you know, in the case of Sydney, the Occupy movement lasted 2 weeks, because for the first meeting, you had 1,500 people who sat down to talk for 4.5 hours about whether or not this should mean the next person over there should have to say, because, you know, and it became this absolutely circular internal discussion, rather than saying, well, look, we've got real concerns that affect the public out there. How do we carry this movement out into the public? And in order to do that, we have to think parallelly, in parallel. How do we organize our own movement? How do we actually not get sort of so obsessed with this idea of internal structure and internal organization that we neglect the broader social problems? I'll also, one quickly, I'll direct this straight to Jelena. You talked about how direct democracy can be used to include people that are often marginalized in broader social discourse. And I think it's telling that it was brought up in this panel, where I think for the first time we almost have equal participation of men and women in this panel. But if you've noticed, I don't know if other people have noticed this in a lot of the other panels, it's been absolutely male dominated. I think someone told me that it's almost 5 to 10% of participants have been women. And I mean, in the context of a leftist organization, we actually should be trying a little bit better about that, because I think this does reflect broader social trends, bigger problems in society that we should be confronting here. So I just wanted to know how you think practically direct democracy can be used in this way to challenge, say, sexism or homophobia, and to actually get people more confident to actually participate more broadly.
So we'll take another question and then you can answer.
I want to conclude something from Macedonian experience. The experience with the participative or direct democracy in Macedonia is from one side very good and from other side bad. It is good because every new leftist organization is organized in a principle of direct democracy. Even the initiatives last year that we made, which were broader, including some normal citizens, were participative also. But one of the problems with the Macedonian left, as I told you yesterday, is in a crisis. It is because, partly because of the participative democracy. But I think that reason doesn't mean that participative democracy is a problem that should be put aside, but we should think about its weaknesses in order to implement it more efficiently. One of the basic principles of participative democracy is to have participative culture. If you don't have participative culture, your democracy will not function very well. For example, the principle of participation that whenever you need to speak, when you think that something is important, then to tell it. But this principle is connected with other principle. Whenever you don't have to say something, don't say it, because it takes time, and time is a very, very precious resource in participative democracy. So, whenever there is a point that shouldn't be made, or someone others has made it, you don't have it to put yourself in the first place and not the point. The second thing is what participation means. It means participation in discussions, but it means participation in actions also. We have some problems with people that understand participation only as a participation in discussion, and often when they should include themselves in the action, to participate in action, they are nowhere. So participation in discussion is okay, but it shouldn't be took aside this participation in action, because a person who participates in discussions and not in actions is a definition of boss. So,
yeah, exactly.
Exactly. So the thing is, To think critically about participative or direct democracy, not to put it aside, but to implement it to achieve democracy and efficiency.
Maybe just a few points. points for discussion if we'll have time. Well, I think there, my position is direct democracy. I'm just worried about the questions of how to operationalize it. So there is a clear place that we're in that you have to break the dominant mainstream discourse. So sometimes it can be used like that. I think we managed to do that in Croatia in 2009, and I think another great example is the OWS, Occupy Wall Street, with the 1% 99% dichotomy. So it is a possible space for the legitimization of the current authority. But it does not automatically solve individual deficits, individual, I don't know, people don't necessarily become different people through the practices of direct democracy automatically. So I'm responding to Diana upstairs, and power is power. I think should be formalized. If there are certain pretensions to power, then such people should be mandated or delegated to some positions, but I don't think the function of knowledge can be formalized so as we have like an official wise man that will tell us what to do. I think that is the place for that should be done in during discussion. It is a very direct democracy is a good tool for protest in order to slow down the protest dynamic, because the powers usually play the game of wearing the protest down, waiting for it to calm down, and the media often respond to spectacles, so sometimes it is good to slow them up down, but it is not only a matter of when we will use direct democracy, it is also a question of how we will use it. For instance, what James was talking about with the flapping of hands and discussing about hand signals. I have had a similar experience in Bochum, where during a five-day congress, there was a plenary each night, and on each night they were discussing about the organization aspects of that congress. So during to the last day, they were still discussing whether we need an info table or an info couch or something like that. So I would mention something that our comrade Igor Livada has said. Direct democracy should be introduced gradually in relation to the possibilities, technical. The place of the media is important. So a sort of a gradual direct democratization of society. And just one thing concerning subjectivation, because this is a question that is connected to direct action mostly, and I would say David Graeber is I think a somewhat problematic guy that says we should act like as we were already free, but the problem is we are not. And I mean, it has certain like you know, like Hamlet. It is a sort of a performative practice. You are showing something to the world, to the wider community. But we really should be aware of that, because otherwise we will come into the peril of having this space for a limited time only, or having it for like we can go into the woods and then be direct democratic, but nobody really cares because we are not bothering the power structures. And another proposal for subjectivation that was linked to direct action is by Saki Bailey. She was here, I don't know, two, three days ago. She spoke about the occupation of the theater in Italy, where they did this like direct action, we are already free, but then they used the Institute of Law and actually found some loopholes to legalize their position, like they are making a committee, something like that. So I think that is a good question of subjectivation through law. because then it becomes generalized. Then it's not just a question of we are free now and here until the cops come, but we are free in the eyes of the law. And otherwise, I mean, it can obviously be used on local levels. And but maybe an increased moment of delegatory and mandatory action should be needed, because really outside of the domain of struggle, really you need to transform it somehow to accommodate the needs of the that particular community that cannot be 24/7 alert for action.
So I think the direct democracy is a model. It's not an aim, or at least I think it shouldn't be an aim for itself in its own terms. So I think that when talking about direct democracy, I don't think that there's just one direct democracy. I think it's what Martin said, or James, I don't know. It's about, it's growing out of movements. So it has the pluses of direct democracy that is that it has a consolidating effect on at the moment of mobilization. And that's when it's used in order to disperse the responsibility and the heaviness of the political pressure and maybe police pressure or in our case university pressure on individuals who are most exposed. So I think that's extremely important to notice. And every time when talking about direct democracy, I'm really tired of mentioning Spain in whatever year. It's the worst example ever. It's everything has changed except for capitalism. I mean, the means of self-organizations have changed. Most of the time we organize ourselves through internet. So I don't think this is something that is to be neglected. What I think that is a problem in Croatia is that direct democracy became a fetish. And so we have all this, we practically now have a movement, you know, of some people who are in direct democracy only because of the direct democracy. So they want to implement direct democracy in everything that lives and breathes and everything that grows. And I think this is bad. And I think this is one of the things, this doesn't mean that I'm against direct democracy. I do like the way we were able to function when we were implementing and we were functioning by direct democracy. But at some point, people forget what Zdravko said, that it's an ongoing process. But sometimes the fact that it's an ongoing process, it actually means that decisions are keep being changed. You know, because if we decide to stick with one decision for, God forbid, 3 days, it would mean that we are not direct democratic anymore. And there was these many, many stupidities such as this. And this was one of the problems. I really do think that some of the things we did were not very well thought through. So I think I also think that when talking about direct democracy, we should be strongly context dependent. So it's one thing to organize something in direct democratic method when it's war, when you have a common enemy from the outside. And it's something completely different to organize a hospital in a direct democratic way. So, and I don't think, I think that because the direct democracy worked for us so well back in the 2009, it started to be like this superior model of organization. But in reality, for the past 2 years, it has it is proven to be not so efficient as it was 3 years ago. So, for example, we had this really big. I'm talking context dependent. So, I'm trying to analyze, not just express my own subjective attitudes, not based on previous thinking. So, we had this really big election in students' body. And so we decided that we were gonna. Actually, we had a couple of plans, but one that succeeded went through in a way that we dispersed the functions and responsibility of the ordinary representatives, and we delegated it all to plenum. So in the end, what happened, so in this so-called peaceful times, what happened is that dispersion of responsibility meant that nobody knows what they're talking about, and the delegates lost their legitimacy in faculty's council. So in previous times, when there were representatives and they were sitting on each and every session of faculty council, you know, things are repeating, especially when you're there for 2 or 3 years, and that's how people usually are, representatives in the students' council that rules the faculty, in a faculty council that rules the faculty. You start to realize at what time of the year some decisions should and will be in order to be decided upon, and these are some of those decisions are extremely important. But when you rotate delegates, they don't know that, and not just that, they don't know the positions of power in the council, and all of these problems turned out to be a big problem for plenum of FFZG, because nobody knows what they're talking about now. So right now, when they have to talk about something that 3 years ago we were the biggest experts in the country, now they're completely lost. They're confused, they don't know what to say, and they keep asking us for the older generations to come and save the day. So, and this is a problem, all of the professors see that, and the students don't know how to handle it, but it's not them that they're, it's not their own fault. We are also to blame because we fetishize direct democracy. So I think when talking about direct democracy, we should always be movement focused. And we should always bear in mind whether if it's a wartime, as we call it, or if it's a peaceful time. So I think and another thing that I think it's very important is that direct democracy is not about direct action, it's not about discussion, it's about decision-making process. And this is the biggest plus of direct democracy that I see, and this is actually, if there would be some other way if there could be some kind of a combination of professionalization, which I'm not against. Sometimes I'm against rotation, but sometimes it's okay to rotate. And but decision-making process is the most important thing about direct democracy, and this is what I think is the minimal common denominator that all movements should have when talking about direct democracy.
I agree with Andrea. What I want to raise is a question: under which conditions direct democracy can succeed? I believe that, as I said before, the direct democracy cannot be a political method. It is clumsy as a method, but it can be a political goal, because we firstly have to create conditions for the direct democracy to function. And I think that it only functions when people are deciding about things that they know what they are talking about, when people share similar knowledge about something. I don't know. For instance, I can give you a positive example of Workers and Punks University in Ljubljana. We are a group of something 15 people, and we are cooperating for years, and we are organized. We have each year a coordinator, and every project we have has its own coordinator, and we have a strict but common decided division of labor and personal responsibility. And that is why we are efficient, and we don't need a hierarchy or something, but hierarchy appears when someone is delegated to conduct a project. And that is why we are efficient, and you cannot say that we are not democratic, because we are deciding as a community. And I think that can be a model, but it cannot be a model that you say, okay, we will fight against capitalism, and all the different people come, and half of them are not aware of problematic of which we are talking. In that conditions, direct democracy cannot function. It could function if we firstly generalize theory. I don't know if everyone read Marx before, and then we can discuss about such complex issues. But I think that for now, direct democracy can function in smaller communities where people share knowledge about the things they are deciding. But on the wider scale, I don't know, in the sense of ruling the state or something, it's a lot of work to be done that direct democracy on those levels could be possible. Thank you.
Okay, we have five more speakers, and then we'll try to come to some conclusions, and please be brief.
Okay, so just for the James objection. So I don't think that direct democracy as such would like resolve the inequalities in a way, and I stated that actually, but I don't also believe that the major groups in the society would like simply decide to hand over their responsibility for decisions to the others in their society only because they think they are not up to the job or so that there is someone more competent in the field. That seems like totally implausible for me. And I think the practice of Plenum in Belgrade to some extent actually showed that. And also regarding this discussion about rotation and everything, there is a certain history of expectation or something like that on the topic how a politician should look like. And this history of expectation is also pretty much connected with masculinity. And also there are some other histories of expectations regarding women. So in that sense, I think rotation is one of the mechanisms to try to include more and more people that do not have direct bodily experience of some practices. And I think that is the way for them to learn those practices and to become better at them or whatever. And it is a kind of way to share different experiences in order to create, I don't know, in some way equality. It brings to the equality, I think, at some sense. So at the plenum in Belgrade, I think we had a practice that, for example, for moderators, it would be better to be people of opposite, two moderators of opposite gender. It was an important issue for us. And I know that this kind of practice and identity politics and representation also can look like a slippery slope, and we can ask why then not left-handed people or not people with green and brown eye and whatever. But I think that kind of issues, as for example in the Plenum Belgrade or whatever, are some kind of being determined by the political and social context of that particular community. For us, it was important to have women moderators because we saw that there was 50% women on plenums and 50% men or whatever. But any other groups that would have any problem that was particular could have been also involved in that kind of practice in a way. So yeah, there are some other things, but maybe we can later catch up.
I will truly be brief. I just have something to say in the related, a comment about Zdravko. We need to talk about the negatives to solve the problems. And what trade unions from Petrokemia said, when you have a group, you always have to have at least 5 to 10% of people which disagree with you. The direct democracy model and the example of student rebellions, we had that in the beginning. The direct democracy model went to three changes. First phase was the phase what Diana said, it was successful. Then less and less people participated. Still, we talked about everyone. The problem with direct democracy is when Zdravko talks about the legitimacy and legislation and legitimacy. You maybe have a legitimacy when you have 10% of students at the, of the entire university at the assembly, but do you have that same legitimacy 3 years after when you have maybe 1 promille of the students' population? That is the problem we need to talk about when we're talking about the technical issues of direct democracy. That's it.
I'm going to be very long, just so you know.
No,
I'm joking. I have a potential answer to the Macedonian representative and Slovenian. When it comes to people not showing up, eventually, when it's really crucial that they do, there are two things that are crucial. It's commitment and people skills. And in order to get them to commit, you have to have people skills. Okay, I'm going to tell you a little story. It's very short and funny. I went to Una rafting all by myself because I couldn't find nobody else at the time that is free or has the money to go with me. So I end up in this boat with a bunch of people from Zagreb. They're all wearing same shirts, and they have loaded like tons of beer cans into the boat. I mean, you literally have to kind of push your way through with the foot to get to the rope and maintain stability. And they were hilarious. But one thing that struck me about them is the following. They look so organized. And I was like, how do you do that? I can't get my friends to go on a field trip and have fun. How do you do it? And they were like, we make everybody commit by putting in a certain amount of money beforehand. And if they don't show up, they don't get it. And I was like, okay, so how many of you showed up? Well, most of us. How many didn't? 2. Okay, what happened? One was ill, the other one was like called back to work. Okay, so what happened to the money that those two people gave? Well, the one who got sick, he got the money returned to him. And the guy who didn't know how to say no to his boss, he didn't. So what happened to the money? Well, we just invited two of our other friends who got to ride with us for free. I mean one, I'm sorry, bad math. So you have to make people to commit themselves. If you want them to come, take their car keys, I don't know, do whatever. But you will truly know that they will come if they commit somehow.
Što se tiče legaliteta i legitimiteta, upravo se da o tome radi, da se legitimitet gradi na taj način da si ti uvjerljiv. Jel? Legitimitet plenuma trenutno meni nije uvjerljiv. Jel? Da. I sad da se nadovežem na to, čisto da se osvrne na to oko fetišizacije direktne demokracije, tu se osjećam osobno prozvan jer sam aktivan upravo u grupi koja gura direktnu demokraciju gdje god može i priča o tome. Upravo se radi o tome da treba brižljivo analizirati i vlastitu organizaciju koja funkcionira direktno demokratski i direktnu demokraciju kao takvu da se ne bi dogodilo fetišiziranje. Mi trenutno živimo u društvu koje fetišizira predstavničku demokraciju. Ja ne vidim da je to sad baš tako dobro. Utoliko smatram ovo izuzetno važnim. Smatram da ako hoćemo govoriti o demokratskom društvu, moramo govoriti o direktno demokratskom društvu. Meni ova predstavnička demokracija nije demokracija. U tom kontekstu sam isto ono što sam govorio da treba analizirati svoj rad i treba analizirati vlastite greške. Nije se... veliki su pritisci na svaku organizaciju koja direktno demokratski djeluje da to ne bude. Zato što je prevladao ovaj drugi način djelovanja. Znači, to treba uzeti u obzir. Ali isto tako treba uzeti u obzir i da se sami problemi ne stvaraju tek tako od sebe. Stvaraju se nepažnjom. Mi smo, ono što se dogodilo sa plenumom, zašto je došlo do toga, meni nije stvar u fetišizaciji direktne demokracije, nego fetišizaciji nas samih koji mislimo da znamo što je direktna demokracija. I to je onaj ključni problem. Da smo mi sebe prozvali arbitrima koji se razumiju u sve, a nismo imali pojma o mnogo čemu. I ono što nam se dogodilo upravo, što se, već smo govorili o toj depersonalizaciji, što se depersonalizacija identificirala sa time da ne smije biti strukture.
da se bilo koji oblik organiziranog djelovanja u smislu davanja mandata i to, znači to je još jedna stvar kad govorimo o rotiranju. Nije rotiranje nešto što se sumanuto mora događati da svaki put neko drugi nešto radi. Rotiranje se radi o tome da što više ljudi zna što više zadataka, ali određeni zadatak neko može raditi duže vrijeme, da pače ovisno o stvarima koje se tu tiču, je i poželjno da ih duže radi. Recimo predstavnici u vijeću fakulteta. Upravo je inzistiranje na tome da taj sustav ne bude takav doveo do cijelog ovog raspada što se dogodio sa plenumom i vrlo mi je problematično da onda, a to se često događa, da isti oni ljudi koji su bili protiv sistematizacije rada unutar plenuma, dakle protiv stvaranja te strukture, sada govore da direktna demokracija ne valja jer nije mogla stvoriti strukturu. Jel?
Okay, so now we'll try to give some conclusions. Of course, we can conclude everything we've discussed, but... Okay, so we'll now draw some conclusions. And then there's going to be a break, but please, I kindly ask you to come to the last panel, where we'll make and discuss and make some conclusions about all the previous Balkan forums at 4 p.m.
An hour break at 4
p.m. We are back here. Okay, now we'll make some conclusions. Hopefully.
Well, I'll try to do it brief, and if I forget anything, please help me if there's anybody left. I think that some of the, let's say, values that were mentioned, especially at the beginning, were, like, I say it in keywords, let's say, things like equality, community, presence, bottom-up, not non-hierarchical structure, non-representation, organization without border. But each of them carries some kind of a problem, structural problem within it. And I think that one of the things everybody mentioned here was that direct democracy is an inventive and accumulative process that can't be defined as a thing. It all the time has to be redefined and rethought. So some of the problems that were brought up were the problem of representation in terms of media representation, in terms of leadership. Does anybody formally or informally represent the whole organization? If there is a leadership, in what way can it be handled in a non-hierarchical way? The division of getting experience, more people participating in different functions, or getting more professional cadres, like now do we have subjectivation? And this, I think, for my in my eyes, it didn't actually, the idea of subjectivation is not finalized here, because I think there were people different things in the discussion. So I think the main thing of subjectivation and mobilization has to be redefined and asked again. Then there was a major question about political participation in a representative system, in the general political system. And in that, what kind of if there is not enough, if we define direct democracy as something that is not based on counting people, if we have low numbers of people, does it mean that we don't have legitimacy? What constitutes at all legitimacy? And I think that one of the major things that came out is the problem of continuity. How people keep being active for many years, or at least widening enough the circle of people who participate. There was also a question of efficiency. If there are too long debates, does it? What kind of direct action comes out of it, and what's the relation between the discussions and the direction that and the direct action that comes out of it? If I forgot something, I try to be brief.
Wouldn't I like something to add? Okay, no. So thank you all for coming. Please, see you at 4 p.m. 4 p.m., everyone.